We're talking now with John McGoldrick, chairman of Caza Oil and Gas. John, thanks for joining us once again. And it's timely that you've come in today because you've announced just today a problem with a well. So what's happening and what's the impact?
Yeah, we just drilled a well called the Matthys-McMillan number 2 well, which gave us a little bit of surprise in that when we were drilling it, we saw gas flow and we saw high pressures, and we required a high mud weight to keep the well under control. Yet when we subsequently tried to complete the well, we believe that the reservoir has poor characteristics and it's tight, and at the moment we're not getting much in the way of production, which is a disappointment. Notwithstanding that, the good thing about dealing and working in Texas is that we tend to have multi-pay potential. And this well has got another zone which is sitting much higher up in the wellbore at about 9,000 feet in the Yegua. The Yegua in the area can be quite prolific. So we're looking at the possibility of doing some further work with the Wilcox sand, which is the deeper sand, or coming up the hole and trying to complete the Yegua sand.
So in a nutshell, how long before you can really assess the news that you've just had and make further announcements as to what you're doing?
Well, we've been in discussions with our partners. We've now got approvals to come up the hole. We're still looking at the potential that we've caused the damage, in the sense that the skin damage because of the heavy mud weights, which is something you do sometimes find with tight gas reservoirs. So we're working around the problem. We'll take a decision very shortly as to whether to come up the hole or not. If we come up the hole, we'll test the section, and then we're going to have to bring in a frack unit. Mm-hmm. Now, frack units in the Gulf are very, very difficult to get a hold of at the moment because of all the shale drilling. So it may take us up to 90 days to get the well fully on production.
Okay. Slightly better news. We did announce last month the start of drilling on the OB Ranch number 1 mm-hmm. well, and you've described this as one of your high impact prospects. Mm-hmm. How many high impact prospects do you currently have?
We've got four that we're trying to get drilled this year. We've got the OB Ranch, which is making good progress, which was also mentioned this morning in the press release. That's getting down to about 10,000 feet ahead of schedule. It's looking good. Touch wood. We've got indications from Devon Energy, which is one of the biggest oil companies in the world, who have farmed into one of our oil prospects in Texas, that they plan to spud the well, subject to lease checks, etc., in September. So that will be quite exciting. Our first big target in Louisiana, which is called the Iron Prospect, which we also farmed out, is due for spud in September too. So we're going to have quite an exciting fall. We've also got a big prospect called the Sanimus, which we're currently marketing to other oil companies in order to get that farmed out. All of those projects have got big potential for the company.
Right.
We're fortunate for a small company that we've got such a good portfolio of potential company makers.
Let's talk about the share price. On the news about the OB Ranch, we were up above 10p, back down to 6.25 now. You have been as low as 3. When are investors going to make money on the share price side of things?
Well, we're an exploration company, and really what we're trying to do is back up the premise of our story, which is that the Gulf Coast is an immature exploration play. And by that I mean that over certainly in England, everybody tends to think that Texas, Louisiana has been drilled. It's been going on for a long time, and therefore there are no sizable reserves left. Our view is that that's completely incorrect, and what we're trying to do is to prove that. Mm. Now, OB Ranch is a good one there, where you've got potential for a big size of gas. It's 40 minutes outside Houston. Didn't see any drilling since 2000. In fact, hasn't seen any drilling.
But let's pin you down. When are they going to make some money, do you think?
Well, whenever we hit one of the big ones, then the potential for having big increase in our share price is there. As I said 2 minutes ago, we've got a great portfolio of opportunities that could easily do that. So soon, I hope.
What about cash? You just announced the divestment of part of the Glass Ranch property for $1.4 million in cash. What's the cash burn, and what will you use that money for, presumably for more prospects?
Yeah, I mean, we had this property that was setting up in New Mexico, it was an oil property, which we didn't see having much upside. Mm. So we took the opportunity to sell that for cash. We're going to use the cash in drilling up our high-impact wells in Louisiana in particular. So what we're trying to do is, within our portfolio, take the cash from things that we don't think have got much upside and apply it to things where we do have a lot of upside. And that, we think, is the best use of funds.
2009 saw a pre-tax loss of, $3.7 million. We talked about the share price. What about profitability? What's the target?
Well, it's not going to take very much to get us back into a profit situation. The disappointment with the well that hasn't performed to date, the Matthys well, is that really that well, if it come on as expected, would have got us into a black situation. That hasn't happened. Perhaps the AGUA will work and that will get us back into it. It's really not going to take much production to do that. Now, once we get that problem sorted, then really what we're trying to do is get serious amounts of value into the company by drilling up these high impact wells. Typically we farm out, so we remove ourselves from the risk. We remove ourselves from the need to fund the well ourselves. And we've done that with Devon, we've done that on the Arn well, and we'll do that in Los Animas. So our cash reserves are actually very modest, apart from our ongoing staff costs.
Okay, John McGoldrick, thank you very much indeed for joining us once again today.
Thank you very much.